I'm Chris Elliott. I'm Professor of Food Safety and Director of the Institute for Global Food Security at Queen's University Belfast. If you think 10, 20 years ago, there are particular seasons where you would start to buy things, particular fruit, particular vegetables, you would only get at particular times of the year. Well, that's gone now. What we can do is we can access basically any food commodity we want at any time of the year. We source food from all over the world. It can come from anywhere at any time of the year. And when we're buying things which are accessible 24/7, 365 days a year, you suddenly think, where does it come from? So in the United Kingdom, we import over 50% of our food now. United States, the levels of imports, for instance, for fish is now 90% of all the fish Americans eat comes from outside the United States. So it is truly global where food is sourced from. There are enormous benefits from having global supply chains. But with those supply chains comes an awful lot of risk associated with them. There's risks of contamination, there's risks of fraud, and the more steps that are in those supply chains, the greater the degree of vulnerability those supply chains are to some sort of catastrophe. In the United States each year, the CDC quotes that somewhere in the region of 48 million Americans have some form of food-related illness each year. And in only about 20% of the cases can they actually identify what the agent was, if it was a pathogen. So there's a huge number of cases of food illness in the United States. Nobody knows the cause of those. And I do believe that fraud, food fraud, probably accounts for quite a substantial proportion of that. Food fraud is cheating. It's when we think we're buying one particular type of food commodity, we are not. And food fraud can take many, many different guises. The best known is adulteration, substitution. So you think you're buying one product and it has been substituted by a cheaper product. But there are many, many other types of food fraud. There is, for instance, addition fraud, where somebody will start to add something to your food to make you think it is worth more, it is a better quality product. But then we've got some of the more complex forms of fraud. We have where food is being sold as being fair trade, as being sold as being organic, as sustainable food supplies, and they aren't. And then you've got to really think, how can science play a role in trying to detect those particular types of fraud? Well, actually, quite often I don't talk about food fraud, I talk about food crime. And when I talk about food crime, it is well organized, it can be national, it can be international. Chains of criminals working together to penetrate complex supply systems. It's exactly what happened in Europe in 2013 with the horsemeat scandal. It was international. To try to detect international food crime is very, very complex, very complicated. And we now have the organizations like Europol and Interpol have dedicated food fraud units. And I think that shows that it is truly something that's happening on the international scale now. So I do see a tremendous change in the culture of food companies now, thinking about fraud. How do you prevent it happening? Because a lot about food fraud is prevention. Detecting it is very nice, but you've got to put measures in place that will prevent fraudsters trying to operate within your supply chain.